Now, the next section we're going to talk about really just takes this idea and runs with it. You see, we stuck with this special case of thermometers for a very long time because they had a mean of zero and a standard deviation of one. What you need to know is that's not really relevant in order to do this problem. You see, a z-score, what's a z-score do? It translates something. You have to know what it translates. Translates what into what? Don't get silent on me. You got to know I've talked about it at least four times in this class. Say that one more time. Very good. That's what a z-score does. So even if I'm not given a mean of zero, and I'm not given a standard deviation of one, I can translate that information into a mean of zero and a standard deviation of one using the z-score. And that's the idea for section 6.3. So are we going to be doing anything different in 6.3? No, same stuff. Same stuff. It's just we're going to be using a z-score, and it's going to actually be relevant. Instead of giving us the same number, it'll give us a z-score that represents the value I'm giving you. Let's look at an example and kind of see exactly what I'm talking about. You ready for it? Okay, so 6.3, we're talking about applications. And really, we are just using a z-score because we know, and I've talked about this at length, that that's going to translate a normal distribution to a standard normal because it maps any mean to zero and any number that's one standard deviation away from the mean to one. Two standard deviations away to two, and so on. So let's look at something that doesn't have a mean of zero. This certain group of men, this population of men somewhere, has a mean weight, which means they averaged all their weights, and their average was 172 pounds. Of 172 pounds and a standard deviation of 29 pounds. You know what's great about this section? You rarely have to find mean and standard deviation on your own. It's kind of nice. It takes a long time. So it's always getting given to you. If it's not, you can find it. It's not a big deal. You know how to do that. It's just a pain. What I want to know is the probability that a randomly selected man from this population will have a weight of less than 174 pounds. I'm putting these numbers up here for a reason, because I'm going to make you very, very good at understanding the difference between a z-score and a probability. I'm going to make you very, very good at that, because you have to know that. Okay, so we got this population. They got a mean weight of 172. Hey, that's me. They got a standard deviation of 29. Find the probability that a random selected man will have a weight of less than 174 pounds. Well, before we draw a picture, we need to translate this thing. We need to translate this score into something that's going to fit on a standard normal distribution. The reason why is because if you look up your table right now, if you put 174, is that on your table? No, you got stuff between 0 and 3, right? 0 and 3.5 maybe. I don't know what's on your table. But it goes up to, I think, 3.5, I believe. That's it. You can't look up 174. So in order to do this, you have to translate this to standard normal. What does that for us? That's it. Find a z-score. Find a z-score. So for us, the first thing we're going to be doing is finding a z-score. That's step number one. Ladies and gentlemen, what is your x value in this case? Good. X is the variable. That's what's changing here. The mean and the standard deviation will not change. So in our case, the x is 174. Can you tell me what is the mean?
172.
Can you tell me what is the standard deviation, please?
20.
Y'all okay with where those numbers come from?
Now,
you know what? One of the biggest mistakes, it's a simple mistake, but it's a huge mistake. Before you start going on your own, please listen for it very carefully. A lot of people will get these numbers screwed up, and they'll always put the big one minus the small one. I don't know why that is, because this formula doesn't change. This formula says x minus mean, no matter what the x is, no matter what the mean is, you do the x first, then you do the mean. You with me? Because otherwise, you'll always get a positive if you always put the big one first. That doesn't make sense. You're going to have negative values. Anything to the left of the mean is going to be negative z-score. So do this in the appropriate order. In our case here, we've got, what's going to come first, 174 or 172?
174.
Minus what?
172.
All over?
9.
So in our case, we have 2 over 29. How much is 2 divided by 29?
0.067?
0.07.
Well, okay, and you're using a z-score, right? Your table only goes to point something something. 0.0 what?
69.
Don't say 67. Don't say that. It only goes to two decimal places. It's okay. 0.0. Yeah. Round appropriately. 7. Your z-score is 0.07. 0.07. We're going to go one minute over. If you have a z-score of 0.07, does this mean that you have a 7% chance of doing that? Is that what that means? No. No, you actually have to put this on your graph. If I draw my picture, here's what this means, ladies and gentlemen. Watch carefully. You're not going to get very many examples like this where it's a point. I just need to make sure that you don't, because what happens on your test, a lot of people go, oh, z-score is 0.07. That's my area. It's less than 1. Yay, I'm done. I go, I have no idea what you're doing. Okay? What you found is a distance from the mean. This is the number of standard deviations away from the mean. Where's the mean here? In the middle, left, right, where's it at?
Middle.
And how much is the mean always?
0.
Where is 0.07 in accordance to the mean? Is it to the right or left? It's positive, correct? So it's just a little, but not much. I mean, 0.07, that's like right there. It's really close. Raise your hand if you're okay with this so far. Here's what you've done right now. You've just translated a normal distribution into a standard normal. This is all the z-score did. I need you to really understand this here, folks. Focus for a little bit. This score is really that number. You with me? It's just this number represented on this picture. That's all it is. You still have to look up and find the area. What value are you going to look up and find the area?
0.07.
Okay. Now, we're looking for greater than or less than?
Less than.
Wait, okay, less than. Should I be shading to the right or to the left?
Left.
Less than, left. If I look up 0.07 on my table, if I plug in negative 10 to 0.07 on my calculator, it's going to give me this area. That's going to be the correct area. So I'm going to do that real quick for me and we'll be done. What'd you get?
0.472.
0.472.
I'm not sure.
It should be greater than 0.5.
0.5279.
On the table?
Yeah, on the table says
0.5279 on the table. Your calculator will give you something a little bit different than this, because your calculator will be exactly accurate up to 4 decimal places. You follow? What's it mean? Well, this interpretation would be there's a 52.8% chance that you're going to randomly select a man and he will have a weight of less than 174 pounds. That's what that says. You'll have to write the interpretation, but that's about it. How many of you feel okay with what we talked about so far? Can you do that? Z-score, draw a picture, look it up, we'll practice more of this next time. Okay, so IQ is normally distributed. It has a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. Here's the question. What we want to do is find out the percentage of people who have an IQ between a certain range. So what percentage of people or another word you could use in this case is proportion. What proportion of people or percentage of people have an IQ between 85 and 125? Note that what IQ means is that most people are going to be around an IQ of 100. That's what the average means. It's the mean is 100. So most people around there, standard deviation is 15, which means when we go right and left by units of 15, we get proportions of data that are increasing as we go out. So firstly, can you identify, please, for me, what is our mu in this case? What's our mu? Very good. That's our mean. Okay. What is our sigma? Good, because that says a standard deviation. So for the population, the mean is 100, the standard deviation, or sigma, is 15. What is my x value? 85. Wait a minute, I have two of them? I guess so. Yeah, it says between two values. Right? That means I'm going to have to look up two scores. I've been saying this a lot, but what we're doing here is we're translating a data value into a z-score. What that does is translates the normal distribution here, by the way. Was this important that I said normally distributed? Yeah. Otherwise, you can't use this stuff. So we're translating a normal distribution into a standard normal distribution by using the z-score. That's exactly what we're doing. Do you remember that? We talked about that a couple times. I asked you to review that. So what we have to do is translate these two scores. Let's call this x1 and x2. These two scores into z-scores, that way we can find out the area between them. You see, right now, there's no way to find out the percentage between these numbers unless we translate it to a z-score. That's the whole idea. We got to translate that to a z-score. Can you guys translate these two x values, these two data values, into z-scores? Okay, go ahead and spend some time. Do that now. Remember, the formula for z-score doesn't change. You'll probably have it memorized if you don't already by the end of this class. Z equals x minus mu over sigma. Make sure you have x minus mu. X minus mu minus mu. Don't do the mu minus x. It's always x minus mu. So the first step in doing this problem is you got to be able to calculate the z-score. That's number one. Translate your data values into z-score values. So the first z-score, if we do 85 minus 125 over 15. By the way, do you have that on your paper, folks? That's fine. I'm glad you don't have that on your paper. How about that? Do you have that on your paper? How many will do? Have exactly that. Okay, how much is that? Notice that if you were to reverse these, you'd get positive 1. Do you see that? And then you'd be looking up the complete wrong thing on your table. So negative 1. I'll put 0.00 just so we're clear on that. Z-scores are always rounded to two decimal places for your table. Z sub 2, we're going to have, that's the 125 minus 100 over 15. Notice how the only thing that's changing is our x value. If you do that, you get 25 over 15. That's going to be how much?
1.67.
Round correctly. You give me 1.66, you are going to be off. 1.66666666 forever is 1.67 according to our rounding. Raise your hand if you're able to get those two things. Good. Now answer this question. What's the next thing I'm supposed to do? Very good. I want a picture of this. I don't want you to just automatically look stuff up. I want to see a picture representing what this means. So our picture says we've just translated to a standard normal distribution, something that looks just like that. Can you all tell me what value is in the middle of the standard normal distribution?
Zero.
Because every standard normal distribution has a mean of zero. So there's only one of them. And now you're going to place these z's appropriately, including the signs. Those signs are important. So negative 1, is that to the right or to the left?
So we're going to put that on our chart, maybe over here. That was our z sub 1.
Our z sub 2 is 1.67. That's, maybe we'll put it right here. Positive 1.67. Hey, give me a little head nod if you're okay with that so far, where these numbers are coming from and how to put them on the chart. Good. The reason why we draw pictures is because this is a graphic representation of this problem now. We've just translated, here's what you've done, so here's what you need to know. We've translated this number into this z-score. You've translated this number into this z-score. That way you can look them up on the table and find corresponding areas. Because it's a normal distribution, corresponding areas are probabilities for these two numbers. Does that make sense? Now, we're trying to find the area, oh, where? Over here to the left? Over here in the middle? Over here to the right?
Middle.
Between. We're trying to find the area between there. So we're looking for this thing. You got a couple ways to do this. If you have a calculator, that's one way. Calculator, right now you'd be looking up normal CDF or norm CDF, putting in the left value, putting in the right value, and pressing enter. True? Did you do that on your homework, by the way? You able to practice that, I hope? On the table. Hey, by the way, your table. You with me? When you find your table, does it give you the area to the left of your value or to the right of your value? So if I'm going to look up this number on your table, it's going to give me all of this stuff, including this area that I don't want. So if I look up this area, someone with a table do that now, how much is that area from 1.67? Notice, on your table, we're no longer looking in the body, we're looking at the sides, because you're looking up a z-score. Are you clear on that? So look up 1.67 and find me the area for that. How much is it?
0.9525.
With a calculator, can you verify that? Well, actually, you can't because you're going to do the middle thing, aren't you? 0.9525. So I looked that up. That gives me this entire area right here. What's the next thing I need to do? What? I do have to look up negative 1. So look up negative 1 in your z-score. It'll be in negative z-scores now. Negative 1.00. How much is negative 1.00? Remember, this is a z-score. I'm looking for the corresponding area to negative 1.00.
0.1587.
1587. Anyone double check that? 1587? And we'll make something, a little comment here on this. A little comment. Even though you have a negative z-score, will your area be negative?
No.
Will your area ever be negative? It is a probability, right? Can probabilities be negative? This is an area is a probability. It's never going to be negative. You'll never get a negative area. So if you get a negative number out of that, wow, you've done something wrong. You've done something incorrectly there. Okay, can you tell me if this whole area is 0.9525 and this whole area is 0.1587, how do I find the area between them? So this area right here, is how much?
7938.793.
Would you agree that the area between these two z-scores is 0.7938? That means that since this represented these two numbers, 85 and 125, that's what we did, translated it. Since this represents this problem, what it interprets as is there is a 79.38% chance that you're going to randomly select someone who has an IQ between 85 and 125. Another interpretation is, since this represents a whole population, 79.38% of people have IQs between 85 and 125. That's most, right? That's most. It's almost 80% of people. About 80% of people have an IQ between 85 and 125. These 20, just over 20% have something outside of that, below or above. Not the same, because we're a little bit skewed to the right here, but, well, I'm sorry, our z-score is a little bit further right than it is left. It's not even, but what we'd say here, interpretation-wise, is one of two things. There's an 80%, 79.38% chance you're going to randomly select someone, and they will have an IQ of between 85 and 125, or other words, you could say is the percentage of people who have an IQ between that range is 79.38. Percent of people have an IQ between those two numbers as stated. So the whole idea, you find your z-score to translate, you look up those z-scores after drawing a picture, and that's going to give you some sort of an area. That area represents the probability that you're looking for. You just need to know that the table gives you always area to the left, so if you're looking for a greater than, you just have to subtract that from 1. You know, there's a couple key points I want to make at this part of the class. Things that I've been talking about, but I haven't really wrote down for you. First thing, we're dealing with z-score. And I can't let you forget what a z-score actually means. What a z-score is really it's a distance. It's a distance that a data value is away from the mean according to the standard deviation. What I described it to you on the first test was that a z-score is the number of standard deviations away from the mean. That's how much it is. This is 1.67 standard deviations away from the mean. This is -1 standard deviations away from the mean. So a z-score is actually a distance. It's not a probability, it's a distance from the mean. Z-score is a distance from the mean, according to standard deviation. Area is a probability. The area you're finding is a probability. If z-score is a distance from the mean, either left or right, and area is a probability, this implies two things for us. First thing, can a z-score be negative? A z-score. Can a z-score be negative?
Yes.
Clearly, we have one right there. That simply means that you are smaller than the mean. Positive z-score means you're bigger than the mean. So z-scores certainly can be negative. Area is a probability. Can area be negative?
No.
No. So whereas you might get some negative z-scores, that's okay, that's allowed. That just means you're looking at a value that is less than your mean. That's what it means. That's what that means. If you have a positive z-score, it's bigger than the mean. We have a distance with a direction, so positive, negative. Areas, it's not that way. In areas of probability, you can't ever have a negative probability. You can't ever have a negative area. Area cannot be negative. Okay, there's one last thing we can do here. The last thing is kind of nice. Do you remember, you probably seen your homework, how I had you look up a z-score, especially for the thermometer problem, that was like the bottom 10% or the top 80%. We realized that like bottom 30% and top 70% actually mean the same thing. Top 90%, and bottom 10% mean the same thing. But we can take that and actually find a data value that represents that information for us. So we're going to go one step further. And I'll say that we can find data values from z-scores. Okay, well, how? Don't freak out, but we're going to do a little algebra. Are you ready? Oh, you should be excited. Aren't you excited to do algebra?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. You scared me for a minute like you weren't excited to do algebra. I'm going to look at the z-score. That's a formula which we all know probably by heart, and of course we love this formula. Now, can you tell me, what is the data value that I'm talking about here? What letter?
X.
Good. What's the mean?
Mean.
What's standard deviation?
Seven.
And Z stands for, clearly, our z-score. The question is, well, normally I go from this side to get a z-score. I look that up in the table, right? What if I'm giving you a z-score? Can you go backwards and find a data value? We should be able to, with an equation, solve for any missing variable that we want. Now, naturally on the problems, I kind of have to give you these two numbers, or you have to have some way to find them. If I give you these ones and this one, you can find a z-score. If I give you these ones, which I will, and this one, you should be able to find that number. So what we're going to do right now is try to isolate this equation for x, and in doing so, we'll be able to translate z-scores into data values. Are you ready? So let's use a little bit of our algebraic skill here. How can I isolate this x term by itself? What's the first thing I need to do? Very good. Yeah. This is divided by sigma, and the way we get rid of sigma, multiply both sides by sigma. That's going to be gone. What we get out of this is sigma times z. Equals x minus mu. Are we done? No, I still want to kind of keep going here. I need to get x by itself. What do I need to do to get x by itself? Now, of course, these are not like terms. So when I do this, wow, that's a W. That's not even a mu. Awful. I get mu added on there somewhere. Notice addition is commutative. It doesn't matter which order I write those things. So I could do sigma z plus mu, or mu plus sigma z. It doesn't really matter. Equals, on the right side, I'm just left with my x. And that really, which I'm going to rewrite over here so you can actually see, is the way we can translate a z-score into a data value. I'm going to rewrite it just slightly. I'm going to write the x on the left-hand side. I'm going to write the mu plus either sigma z or z sigma. It really doesn't matter. So I'm going to write z times sigma just to switch it up a little bit. Multiplication, just like addition, is commutative. So on the left-hand side, I had mu plus sigma z. So here, I'm just switching the sides. Here, I have mu plus sigma z, or z sigma. Raise your hand if you were able to follow down that algebra. Good. Well, now what this lets you do is, now I get a z-score, you give me an x. It's kind of nice. Would you like to try an example to see how this thing works out? Okay. Same steps, really. We're going to do a sketch, only this time we're working a little bit backwards. We're going to draw a picture here, identifying the top or the bottom, whatever percent that I'm giving you. You'll use that to find the z-score. You'll use that z-score to translate that into a data value. So steps again are picture, find a z-score, use that to solve for x. We're going to use our weight example again. The weight of those, remember those men that we calculated? Well, we didn't calculate them. I gave you the men's weights, the mean and the standard deviation from our example from yesterday, Monday. The mean weight was, what did I give you, 172 pounds. With a standard deviation of 29 pounds. So this is that weight example. Here's how your questions are going to be worded. To go backwards and actually find a data value, one way you can see this is, what data value separates the lightest, in this case the lightest, or shortest, or smallest, or least, from greatest? So in our case, I'm going to ask it, what weight separates the lightest 99.5% from the heaviest 0.5%.
Are you applying the empirical rule on that one?
No. No, I'm not applying the empirical rule because we're talking about everything to the left of a certain point, not between standard deviations here. Is that heaviest?
Yeah.
What weight separates the lightest 99.5% of people from the heaviest 0.5% of men? Notice how I said weight. I didn't say I'm really looking for an area. I'm giving you an area. I'm not looking for a z-score. I don't just want the z-score. I want the actual weight value. Do you see the difference in the problem? Before, when we did this with the thermometers, a very similar example, I said, what's the top 10% or what was between this percentage? And you gave me z-scores. And coincidentally, those z-scores were the actual thermometer readings because the mean was 0 and standard deviation was 1. That was awesome. Here we don't have that case. We're able to do just slightly more work. Same basic idea on setup, though. Same basic idea. We're still going to draw a picture. Remember all that stuff about finding the top 10%, bottom 30%, and so on and so forth? I said you had to be pretty good at that. Let's see how good you are, because this is where we need to use that stuff. What's the lightest 99% mean? I need you to understand where the lightest 50% is, and then move from there. So when you're faced with this type of problem, identify at least the smallest or lightest 50%, or top or bottom 50%, and then work from that point. So you tell me, where's the lightest 50%? Is it here or here? This is a number line, right? This is our weights on a number line. So the lightest 50% would not be over here. This would be the heaviest 50%, and this would be the lightest 50%. Are you with me? Now, we want the lightest 99.5%. Where's the lightest 99.5? If this is the lightest 50%, this would be like the lightest 40%, right? This would be like the lightest 10%. You with me still? This would be like the lightest 60%. Where do I need to put my line for the lightest 99.5%? You stop me when I'm there. No? Okay, so we're way over here. I'm going to erase that. That was our 50% mark. Would you guys agree that this is the lightest 99.5%? And this would be the heaviest 0.5%. Notice how those things are working together, right? Let's translate the percents now into a decimal. What's 99.5% as a decimal, please? This represents 0.995 as a proportion of the area. Okay, be careful. What is this? 0.5% as a decimal. 20?
Yeah.
Good. I put 0 point so you can see the point, but 0.005. Are you with me so far?
Yeah.
Okay, now. We have now, what is this? Is this a z-score or an area?
Area.
It's an area. So what we're looking for is the z-score now that represents 99.5% that's below it and 0.5% that's above it, or 0.995 is below that to the left of it and 0.005 is above that. Can you go ahead and find a z-score that represents this information?
Yes.
You could use your table for that, right? You could also use inverse norm on your calculator for that. My question is, on your calculator or table, what should you be looking up? Should you be looking up 0.005 or should you be looking up 0.995 and why? 0.995, very good, and why? Okay, so the table along with your calculator will only give you z-scores if you plug in the area to the left. So I no matter what I give you, you are going to translate it so that you know what this area is, and that's what you are looking up. Are you clear on this? Okay, so go ahead and do that now. I'll give you a few seconds. Look at your table, look at 0.995, or inverse norm on your calculator, 0.995 either way, because that's the area to the left, and that is going to give you, say that again? 2.58? Anybody else get 2.58? How about someone on the table? Did you get it?
2.575.
Okay, which rounds to 2.58. On your calculator, what did it give you exactly?
Like 2.575.
Okay. I didn't remember any of that, actually. I'm just going to say.
That's why I just showed you that.
Thank you. 2. Let's use the table. 5, 7. You said 5.
Yeah.
2.575. Is it one of those little dot things?
Yeah.
Yeah, it should be. Should be a special little dot thing. The asterisk that you follow down. Were you able to follow that down? Should give you that number. Yes. No. Okay. So 2. What is this? What is that? Is that a pound or is that a z-score? So you can't say this, right? 99.5% of men weigh less than 2.575 pounds. Then I am extraordinarily heavy. I weigh 173 pounds. If you leave this as your answer, do you have it right?
No.
I'm looking for the weight, right? If you put 2.575, what you've given me is a z-score. What you need to do is use the information and translate that into a weight. First question, how many people feel okay with drawing the picture just like that? Just the picture. Okay, if you're not raising your hand, I'm going to assume that you don't get it. How many people feel okay with drawing the picture? Picture? Okay, good. How about looking up the z-score from the picture? Good. Now, lastly, since we have our z-score, we now have this information. Let's see if we know what all this information is. Do you know what the x value is?
No.
That's what we're trying to find. That's a weight. Do you know what the mu is? How much is that? Do you know what the z is?
29.
That's what we just spent all this time finding, 2.575. Do you know what the sigma is?
Yes.
29.
That's 29. I want you to plug the information into that formula and find out the x formula, okay? Let's see, mu was 172, that's a pound, plus z is 2.575, that has no units to it, times standard deviation was 29, that's a pound, so we're going to be adding pounds plus pounds, so the units actually do work. Order operations say you multiply, then you add. So you're taking 172, you all understood where that came from, right? That's our mean. 2.575, that's what you spent so much time finding, so you have to be able to do this. That's why I taught it to you last section. In order to do this, you have to be able to draw this picture correctly. Otherwise, if you actually looked up this, 0.005, you'd get negative 2.575. That would not give you the correct thing. Times 29, which is given to you. Have you done the work yet? How much is your x?
246
what?
0.675.
675. What is that? What's the units for that? That's pounds. this interpretation. I want you to think on it. Don't say it loud. Just think of the interpretation, what we just did, okay? What we just did, of course, is to make a picture representing 99.5% of the data below some value. That translated to a z-score. Then we use our formula to make a z-score into an x value, a data value. So what does this number represent? You tell me. I mean, it can't just be, oh, I found a number.
The weight that separates the lightest from the heaviest.
Okay, how much? How much? What percentage of people is less than this weight? Is less than that weight? What percentage of people is less than that weight?
99.5%.
So this is your upper bound for 99.5% of the male population according to this information. Do you understand the interpretation of that? This class is all about interpretation. Before, it was pretty easy. You just calculate the mean, you give the mean, that's it. You calculate standard deviation, that's it. Now we're using it. You know, I mean, you can't just be calculating Z's and going, I'm done, the answer is 245. All those questions that a lot of you leave blank, the part B and C on your homework. Where you go A, B, and then C is interpretation, you go, and you skip it, right? That's the whole point of the class, is part C. That's it. This stuff is easy. You're all required to get this stuff right. The next part is the interpretation. That's the important stuff. This is a bunch of BS if you don't know how to interpret it. It's pointless. It's absolutely pointless. You got to make the next step and know that this represents the upper bound for 99.5% of the male population as far as weight goes. So you'd say, oh, well, if I'm making a car, I want the seat to hold up to people who weigh at least 246 pounds. Because I want it to support 99.5% of my male population who's going to be driving that sports car or whatever car you have. Right? Do you need it upwards of supporting 500 pounds? No. Because that's you're never going to get 100% of the population. But 99.5, that's a pretty good range. You with me on that? That's how you use this stuff. Is it's giving you a, oh, okay, I can build my stuff according to most of the population. Here's my data value that represents 99.5% of the weight. 99.5% of people are going to be less than that as far as this information, if this is accurate, which I just made up the top of my head, so it's probably not accurate, but that would be the whole idea. How many people understood the interpretation part of that? Good, okay. All right. Shall we do one more example? I'll have you do most of it on your own. I'll have you go step by step. We'll cover each step individually so you make sure you get it right piece by piece, okay? Do you know that when I gave you a car example here, like the weight of the seat could support. Did you know that when they organize cars and they develop them, that they actually take this into account, especially grip reach? Grip reach is what you can reach without moving forward. So like all this stuff would be in my grip reach, but this over here would not be in my grip reach. You'd have to move. So if you're driving in a car and you want to change the radio, you don't want to have to go, right? So they're probably not going to put the radio on the back seat or on your dashboard, right? Because you're not going to want to have to do this because you're going to switch lanes and you're going to hit me because I have that kind of luck. I'm like, dang it. There goes Jared changing his radio. I get taken out because you want to listen to different songs. Just stick with the song, all right? You don't have to change songs when you're driving down the road. And listen to music. You should have your own thoughts. Anyway, whatever. So they look at grip reach and how long people's arms are in general. And typically, women have shorter arms than, not like this short, but you have shorter arms than men. And so what they do is they look at a woman's grip reach for that car, and they try to make it so that they don't have to reach too far to hit things. Otherwise, that increases accidents, they get sued because they made their car incorrectly. Are you with me on this? Are you sure? I just said a lot of words in about 30 seconds. All right. So here's a car company. They did their own research, and they found out that if they take into account all the women in the United States, which is their market area, that the grip reach for women is normally distributed. Is that an important statement?
Yes.
Absolutely, because otherwise you would not be able to translate this into a standard normal distribution. It's normally distributed, And the mean grip reach is 27 inches. That means that a woman should be able to reach 27 inches and touch something or grab onto something without having to lean. Okay, so from her car, she should really go and touch something, on average. You're all going to go home and measure arms now, aren't you? Up to par? Did I make it? Yeah, basically it's just the distance from here to your fingertip. Yeah, that's, or, well, your hand close if they're doing the actual gripping onto something. Mean is 27 inches with a standard deviation. By the way, you're always going to get a mean and a standard deviation because it's not just enough to know the average, you have to know how it's spread out, and that's the standard deviation part of this. With a standard deviation of 1.3 inches. Here's what a car company wants to do. They don't want to make it so that only 5% of the people can 5% of the people can actually reach something without moving. They want to make it so that 95% of the people can reach something without moving. Does that make sense to you? So what we want to do is find the reach that represents the top or longest 95% of the population. You know, let me change value to grip reach just so we're specific here. Find the grip reach that's supposed to say grip reach that represents the longest 95% of women. Grip reach room is normally distributed. That's great. Got a mean of 27 inches, standard deviation 1.3. No problem. We can use that information just a little bit. We want to find the longest 95%. So that only the women with the 5% of women who have really short arms will have to reach for something. Does this make sense to you? So 95% of the women in the world, in the United States, will be able to reach out and touch this. Maybe it's a CD player they're putting in there. They'll figure out how far away they can put it, so that 95% of the population can reach it with no problem, and the other 5% maybe has to reach it a tad bit. Are you ever going to make it so that everyone can reach it? What if someone has no arms? Okay. Okay. So they could. I mean, I've seen a woman drive with her feet. I drive my knee all the time. Don't ever say that. Make a U-turn. It's. Work on my hip flexors. So we're going to make it so that 95% of the ladies can do this with no issue, all right? The only time you're ever going to have this with really, realistically, no problem is if you had it in the center of your steering wheel and then someone just put in the CD, but that would be bad because as soon as your airbag popped, boom, CD in the chest. You're done. You don't want to do that. So what's the first step? That hurt, actually. What's the first step in doing this problem? What are you going to do? Draw a picture then. Draw a picture. That's your first step. Draw a picture. And stop after that. We'll do it together. By the way, every picture looks the same as far as the start goes. Are yours always lopsided?
Yes.
Isn't that funny? You get better as you go. This is taking me 12 years to perfect my distribution. Now the important part is not drawing this picture, it's figuring out where to put your line. We're looking for the longest 95% of women's grip. So the first thing I've told you to do here is identify the 50 mark. Okay, identify, just go to 50-50. Identify what's the longest and what's the shortest. Which side represents the longest 50%? Is that the left side or the right side? This is the longest. Okay, this would be short, long, short. It's always climbing. So this is the longest 50% of women's arms. This is the shortest 50%. This would be like the longest 10%, right? This is the longest 50%. This would be like the longest 60%, 70%. We want the longest 95%. So your picture should look something like that. It doesn't have to be precise, but it has to at least be on the correct side. How many people were able to draw that picture? How many people put it over here? Raise your hand. Okay, not everyone raised their hand. So we'll try this again. You only have two options, right? How many people put it over here? Raise your hand. Good for you. How many people put it over here? Raise your hand. That's okay. If you made a mistake, you're learning. That's fine. Just make sure that you're starting with the 50-50. That might help you. Start with the 50-50 and increase the side that you need. So if we want if this is longest and you need more than 50%, go that way. If you need less than 50%, go that way. If you would start with the shortest, this is shortest. If you need more than 50%, go this way. Less this way. Does that make sense to you? That's where you start. So here we got the longest 95%. We'll translate that to a decimal. What's this as a decimal? 0.05. Okay, great. Can you tell me what's the next thing that you should be doing at this point? Z-score, very good. Z-score, find me a Z-score. Find me a Z-score. Can't borrow this? Do you think we'll be in positive Z-score or negative Z-score? Probably negative, because our tables look like that. So negative Z-scores. And last thing, ladies and gentlemen, should we be looking for a number over here in the sides or here in we'll call this the body? Definitely the body, because I'm giving you an area. I'm giving you the probability. Have you all found the Z-score?
Yeah.
Did you look up 0.95 or did you look up 0.05?
0.05.
Why 0.05? So we need to know in every case the area to the right and left. That we need to know both because you're going to be finding the area to the left all the time. So we look up the 0.05 on the body of your table. That will give you a corresponding Z-score. Or you use inverse normal and just plug in 0.05. That's area to the left. In either case, you should get 1.645 or negative?
Negative.
Is the negative important?
Yes.
Are you done?
No.
No, this is not inches. This is a Z-score that's representing your data value right now that you're still looking for. So right now what I'd like you to do is the next step. And the next step is take that Z-score in combination with your mean and standard deviation, find me the X value now.
If you look for the 0.95 on the graph, you won't find the negative 1.64.
No, you get positive.
You get a positive?
Yeah, that's the whole deal, right? You got to have that picture right. Because if you have it over here, and you look at 0.95, you are going to get positive 1.645. And you're going to design your car so that instead of having only 5% of women not be able to reach it, only 5% of women will be able to reach it. That'd be a bad thing.
So if it's negative, you look for the outside all the time. And if it's positive, you look for the inside.
Backwards. If you're looking for an area on the left that's smaller than 50%, your Z-score will be negative. If you're looking for an area that's greater than 50%, your Z-score will be positive.
No, I know, but you look for the outside range, like the outside number, right? Not what you're shading, but...
I haven't shaded anything. You actually don't even need to shade your graph on this. You shouldn't be shading your graph on this. This represents a split. This graph represents a split. If you're shading, that's fine, but notice that you're just taking a value that's representing a separation between the lowest and highest of some number, or shortest and longest, or lightest and heaviest of these values. So when you draw your picture, I don't care about the shading. What I care about is you have this line in the appropriate spot, these numbers are correct, and you're always looking up the area on the left. That's what I care about. Okay, always on the left. That will give you the appropriate Z-score. Did that make sense to you? Okay, now, when you find your X value, X, of course, is the mean plus the Z times the standard deviation. So in our case, x is the mean, which was 27, plus the z, which is, what's the z again?
-1.26.
I'm going to put that in parentheses so you know that's a negative. That way we don't lose that. Times 1.3. So order of operations says we're going to take negative 1.645 times 1.3 and then add on that 27 to it. What do you get? You should get something less than 27, shouldn't you?
Yeah.
What was that value again?
24.865.
Let's just leave it 86. 24.86. That's now in inches. You see, this isn't in inches. You can't leave it here. We found the data value in inches. So what this represents, here's the interpretation. I have to leave you with this. The interpretation is, if you build your car with a grip reach for your CD player of 24.86 inches, 95% of women will be able to reach it with no problem. 5% of women will have to reach a little bit to reach that CD player. How many people understood the interpretation? Also, if you work backwards, if you found a Z-score for this, you know what your Z-score is going to be? I hope you do. You better. What's your Z-score supposed to be for this? It's that, right? That's how we got that value. If you look up that, it's going to give you this area to the left and right. It's not like we're doing anything different. We're just working in a different direction. Did you understand today, folks?
Yes.